I think this is one of those cases where you can reasonably come down with two differential diagnoses, which is astrocytoma versus ependymoma. But in a limited board exam question where you have to pick the best answer, I think I would pick A over D. So let's look at some of the features that favors astrocytoma over ependymoma. As you know, when you see a spinal lesion, the first thing that you need to do is to localize which compartment this lesion fits in. This is an intramedullary lesion. Other lesions such as extramedullary, intradural versus extradural, they have a different differential diagnosis. This lesion is very expansile, so very much a mass-like lesion. It is Bryan T2, Bryan Stir, and I put down parentheses because vast majority of pathology is going to be Bryan T2, so that's not a very helpful feature. In this particular case, you see no enhancement at all, which is actually quite uncommon for either astrocytoma or ependymoma. So this is a good case that in reality, sometimes lesion does not follow the textbook description. There is no evidence of hemorrhage, so there's no hypointensity on T2 weighted sequence. So if I see hemorrhage, I would favor ependymoma over astrocytoma. Another small clue, this is a 20-year-old, so younger patient or pediatric patient, that favors astrocytoma, whereas ependymoma tend to occur in older adults or adults. So let's talk about other choices that do not work as well. First of all, ependymoma, which in real life should be your top two differential diagnosis for intramedullary corneoplasm. This is a nice example from Radiopedia. For those of you who doesn't know about Radiopedia, that's a great resource for radiology. They have an example of a picture that's much better than what I have in my collection. So between those two, there are some distinguished features that could be helpful for making the differential diagnosis, both in real life and board exam. For patient's age, pediatric patient, young adult, tend to favor astrocytoma, whereas ependymoma tend to occur in older adults or adults. Of course, there's a lot of crossover, so you can have kids with ependymoma, especially those with NF2. On the other hand, of course, you can have adults with astrocytoma. On the cross section, because ependymoma is derived from the ependymal cell lining the central canal, so when they develop, they tend to develop from central out. So on cross section, they tend to be central in location, whereas astrocytoma tend to be asymmetric or eccentric compared to ependymoma. But in reality, when they get this big, they tend to occupy nearly the entire core. So therefore, they all look kind of like central in location. Hemorrhage. It's a fairly common for ependymoma. It's one of those lesions that can show hemorrhagic component, whereas it's relatively uncommon for astrocytoma. Therefore, if I see evidence of prior hemorrhage, such as in this case, you can see this so-called hypodensity around the tumor, the hemosiderin capsid, I would favor ependymoma over astrocytoma. The hemosiderin capsid is not pathognomonic for ependymoma. Any type of core lesion that can bleed can also show evidence of prior hemorrhage, especially things like hemangioblastoma. That can also show hemosiderin capsid. What about other answers such as B, schwannoma? We can eliminate that possibility pretty quickly because, as you know, location is very important. Schwannoma is not an intramedullary lesion. In fact, if I show you a lesion that's intradural extramedullary, you should think about schwannoma versus meningioma. And also, both schwannoma and meningioma, they tend to enhance quite avidly. So therefore, it doesn't fit this case as well. But most importantly, the location absolutely does not fit, so you can eliminate B very, very quickly. Choice C, transverse myelitis. While transverse myelitis can show some core expansion because of acute inflammation and edema, you should never see this expansile look exactly like a big mass lesion. Transverse myelitis tend to be longer than 3 vertebral body segments, so that's a nice distinguished feature between this versus, for example, MS. This looks very much like a tumor. It does not look like a mildly expansile transverse myelitis at all. For choice E, core infarction, remember the patient's presentation is progressive weakness. That does not fit the patient's symptom. Right? For core infarction, it should be a very rapid acute event, not progressive weakness. Also, imaging-wise, Remember, spinal cord anteriorly is supplied by one single artery and posteriorly by two posterior spinal arteries. Therefore, majority of acute core infarction tend to involve in just the anterior two-thirds of the cross-sectional area. Often, you will see the involvement of gray matter, look like owl's eye or snake eye appearance. Now, this expands out hollow core involvement, and that would be very atypical for core infarction. Therefore, the overall picture favors astrocytoma, with the second reasonable choice being ependymoma. That's all for this spine case number 10. Good luck on your board exam. Thank you.